every day we didn't have class, essentially.
You get the source code?
Yep.
Okay.
Looked over a little yesterday.
Yeah, it's not real pretty, but like I say, it's fairly straightforward, I think.
I'm currently writing a program that has inline assembly in it. I can't really see it out pretty.
Okay. We were just talking about Google SketchUp. Apparently has a
You play Ruby, don't you?
Yep.
Ah, it's got a Ruby. It's a Ruby scriptable.
Oh, sorry.
It's a Ruby scriptable vector graphics engine, essentially. It's
pretty cool.
And as a telling me that to be able to parse the something going on.
Right. Later.
So that would be pretty hot to have like a pretty cool SketchUp version of a 3D matrix simulator.
You should look into it because I think literally, especially, are you looking into the source code for the simulator? Mm-hmm. Yeah, if you understand, if you can get the data out of that code, I think, and if you already know Ruby, you're probably talking like an hour or two.
So I can do it with that, or I thought about the Java Qt bindings as well.
Yeah, that might be good too. Of course, the SketchUp has all of the tools already there. All you have to do is create the objects and update it.
That's true.
Cool, because a good 3D interface would really rock. And it would actually make my life really easy in the next few months. Easier. Alright, any questions for Monday? Monday was a different sort of lecture. We talked about the halting problem with the homework question on Friday and went from there into sort of a general question about limits to computability and things that can and cannot be decided and some seeming paradoxes related to that. And most of that is not going to come back to haunt us, but we will touch on some of it again later in the semester. So there's no PDF version of the lecture for that. The video is online if you want to watch it. And a reminder, something I mentioned on Monday, Friday, again, it's going to be no new material. I'll come in, and if you're working on the third long homework problem, the sequences and circuits that copy cells from one spot to another, if you're stuck or you have questions or you want to, you know, have me go over specific things, just come on in with your laptop on Friday. I'll be here during class time. And it's definitely a doable problem. It's got a few different pieces to it, but we can definitely get through it. So if you're stuck, come by and work on it Friday. And on Monday, we talked about the halting problem, and we talked about this I am lying paradox. And then I went about to something called diagonalization, Cantor diagonalization. And said that it was related to the halting problem and the I am lying question, and talked about sizes of infinity, the fact that there's infinite numbers of integers, there's an infinite number of reals, but there's somehow more reals than there are integers, and the way that can be shown using diagonalization, and then something called the continuum hypothesis, which turns out to be an undecidable question. It's a question you can't prove or disprove, no matter how hard you try or how smart you get. Similar to the halting problem, which in general, if you're given a program, you cannot tell if it's going to halt or not halt at some point. It's an undecidable question. And then I mentioned sort of more general undecidability and completeness, Kurt Gödel, who showed that that's sort of an inherent property of any axiomatic system you build up in mathematics. You can't make it complete enough that everything can be decided. But in all of that, I actually neglected to go back and tell you why you can't solve the halting problem. There's a fairly simple way to see it, and a few people mentioned this in their homework answer. Basically, when we looked at the integers versus the reals, what we did, we took an assumed solution. We said, okay, the integers and the reals have the same number of elements. That means there's a one-to-one mapping. So we took that assumed mapping and then drew a picture of it on the board and literally moved down the diagonal and made changes in a way that we deliberately forced a contradiction, and that contradiction proved that original starting point, this assumption, could not exist, this solution. That's the general technique of diagonalization, and that's what you can do for the halting problem. So you have a program P, let's suppose it's written in C, and this solves the halting problem. You can give this the source code to another program written in C, and it'll tell you whether that program eventually halts or runs forever. Okay, that's what we're assuming. You have this solution to the halting problem, and it's this program P. So since P is written in C, it's got a bunch of code up here that does something, and at some point it concludes the program halts, and it'll print out the program halts. And then there's probably some more code, and somewhere else it'll print out the program never halts. And all that missing logic is what decides which of those print statements is going to be executed for your input program. So we can modify this program by adding an extra statement after each of these prints. If we say the program halts, then we enter an infinite loop. And if the program says the program never halts, then it just does an exit zero, goes back to the operating system.
Wait, that doesn't make sense.
What's that?
If it halts, it should finish, right?
That's sort of the point.
Well, this is just analyzing a program. Okay, this is just something you feed it source code. You feed it a C program, and it goes through some logic, and it will print out one of these two messages, mm-hmm. telling you that this program that it's analyzing either halts at some point or doesn't. Mm-hmm. Okay, now we're taking this program P, and we're just making a change to it. Mm-hmm. Okay, we're just adding something that happens after it already tells you whether the program halts or doesn't halt. Okay, but yeah, we're doing something very peculiar. When we say the program halts, we go into an infinite loop. If it says the program never halts, then it just comes back to the operating system. And so now if we take this and we call this program P prime, and we ask it to analyze itself, we've rigged the game in our favor. Because if the program analyzes itself, it's going to have to decide either it halts or it doesn't halt, right? It's got to come up with one answer or the other. So suppose it decides the program halts. Well, the next thing the program does is it enters an infinite loop. And it gave me the wrong answer, because it told me it halted and it's never going to halt. And if instead it concluded the program never halts, well, the next thing this program does is it exits. And it halts, exits. And so again, the program gave me the wrong answer. So you gave me this program P that you said solved the halting problem. And I'm showing you that if that's true, I can set up this case where there's a contradiction no matter what the program concludes. Okay, exactly like the I am lying paradox. Anytime you decide I must have been telling the truth, that quickly leads you to I must be lying, and vice versa. Okay, I don't buy this argument personally. I'm still trying to work out the details of why. But I don't personally believe that adding these statements is a benign operation. There are programs, the argument when you read this on Wikipedia or something says, you know, if this original program solves the halting problem, right, if this solves the halting problem, then clearly this will too. Because all you're doing is changing code that doesn't affect the logic. Right, but I don't think that's a valid argument. So I think that's a simplified version of how you prove the halting problem can't be solved. But there is something deeper going on, and there's manuscripts that delve into it more mathematically. Okay, so anyway, that was the fullest version of the short homework answer. The short answer was, you can't solve the halting problem. Okay, so I wanted to talk about a couple of different versions of cells today, different versions of self-modifying systems. And the first one is the idea of an analog cell leading to an analog cell matrix. And the cell matrix we've been talking about is purely digital. It's Boolean operations, it's binary inputs, it's binary outputs, and the truth table contains ones and zeros. And that's useful in terms of setting up digital circuitry, which is most of what we have in our laptops, cell phones, and so on. Cell phones have analog components also for the radio and such. But digital circuitry gets you pretty far, but you can do a lot of different things with analog circuitry, such as making a radio transmitter. So there's things called op-amps. An op-amp is a very simple device. It's an amplifier. It's drawn with a triangle here. It has two inputs and an output. And it's been a while since I've analyzed these, but I think all you need to know is that I think there's no voltage drop between input and output, and there's no current in and out of these. Something like that. It's some really, really simple rule. Is that right? Okay. But with these, you can design all kinds of other circuits, such as general amplifiers, waveform generators, and so on and so forth. They're a very general purpose building block, kind of like an AND gate is sort of a general purpose logic block. Op amps get you pretty far. You also have things like resistors, which limit current, capacitors, which I mentioned a few lectures ago, will actually do differentiation. They'll differentiate an incoming voltage and generate current accordingly. So you have these so-called discrete components, things that aren't logic gates, but that actually change the current and voltage passing through them. And by putting these together in different ways, you can create all the things that exist outside the digital world. Okay, so very useful circuits. So one idea for an analog cell matrix is basically build some general circuit inside each cell, but with component values that can be specified by configuration. So the inputs and outputs to each of these cells would be real valued numbers. They'd be, say, a voltage between 0 and 1 volt, or 0 and 5 volts. And they could take on any value, not just above or below some threshold. And then in D mode, you simply have a circuit sitting inside a cell. There's inputs coming in. It gets processed through whatever the circuit is that's been built, and it generates outputs. That's a very straightforward mode in which a cell would operate. And you can still treat analog signals as being binary. You can have some threshold, and if you're above this threshold, it's a 1, if it's below, it's 0. And when you look inside a digital logic gate, it's actually still an analog circuit. Okay, it's just that everything is usually driven either to 0 or above a threshold where it maxes out, but still an analog circuit. And then in C mode, basically you take the D inputs coming into a cell, and you compare them to whatever threshold, say half the maximum voltage, and you basically treat them as ones or zeros and store them in a truth table based on the ticking of some system clock as usual. So the truth table itself, for example, if we had 16 values in the truth table and 8 values for each row, well, these first 8 bits could be a digitized version of the value of some resistor R1. So you're going to have 256 different values for that. And then you have 256 values for a resistor 2, values for a capacitor. You might have some Boolean flags that indicate which outputs are connected to which inputs inside the circuit, and so on and so forth. And to configure this, you basically just feed in a pattern of ones and zeros to set up the circuit however you want. And then when you go back into, so you configure it the same way, you put a C input high and you start feeding in D inputs. And then when you go back into D mode, these values are locked into each of the components and you basically have a fixed analog circuit inside that's just taking inputs and generating outputs. Yeah?
Are they all going to be some variants of an RC circuit, or can you actually specify like what is a resistor, capacitor, conductor, et cetera, along with the value?
Well, that's a good question, and I was going to mention some ideas for projects in here, and that's one of the big questions, just finding what a good general purpose circuit is. If you put in a lot of resistors and you allow their values to go all the way from zero to infinity, if they go to zero, it's just a wire. If they go to infinity, it's as if it's physically removed. So you can make a big network of resistors and capacitors and inductors, maybe, and through configuration, basically install them or remove them from the circuit, make and break connections and so on. But what that circuit should look like is still an open question at this point.
So are you talking about emulating the analog components with digital components, or
ideally,
how would you make them configurable so you can actually change their value?
Well, you can get variable resistors that basically have a register inside, and you load in an 8-bit value, and it controls what the resistance is. And so you can build something out of those.
How big is that, though, as far as density goes?
Well, I think they can be pretty small. I mean, not as small as a simple piece of polysilicon to make a real resistor. But none of this stuff is small at this point. But you could definitely build something reasonable size with a bunch of cells on it, I think, using these things. Now, they're not, I don't think they're terribly easy to integrate at this point. I mean, you can buy a chip, which is a variable resistor, but I don't know if you can buy something more general. But you can put one together on a board and make a stab at it.
I mean, the other thing is, probably for the more interesting things that you could do with these circuits, you'd want an analog input. So if you're going to have an interface with digital inputs, it's going to be kind of hard to have do anything real unique.
No, you definitely want analog inputs and outputs. The only thing that's digital is sort of the truth table values themselves. And that may not have to be digital. And we'll talk about an alternative to that in a few minutes. But I'm definitely envisioning inputs and outputs, just straight analog signals. So you can do things like have an amplifier or waveform generator or whatever.
Well, too, you can build all of these components on silicon.
Mm-hmm.
Transistors, capacitors, or yeah, capacitors and resistors, and
yeah, inductors are a little harder, yeah, but you don't necessarily need them. Yeah,
but you know, all you need is a bunch of multiplexers.
Multiplexers.
I mean, just to select which.
Oh, to select. Yeah, if you had all the different resistor values.
Yeah, you just have them all.
And that may be what goes on inside these.
Yeah, that's how they have a little light.
They actually have them all in there, but they're smart about it. They combine them in ways to use them.
Yeah, logic. Yeah. I'm sure there's plenty of engineering going on, but I think they're all done in silicon.
Yeah.
But see, then you got current issues.
Yeah.
The more current you plan on having, the less feasible the.
Right, and especially if you're talking about analog circuits anyway, you're going to want to do things like, you know, if you're doing an amplifier, you're going to be driving a lot of current on the output.
Right.
Even if you're not worried about the processing.
Although it'd be fun to make a sound effects box out of
Oh, totally.
Analog sound matrix.
Yeah, absolutely.
Parallel sound effects.
So some general questions. Like I say, what's a good general circuit for this? It's pretty easy in the digital world to come up with a general purpose building block, right? You just have all possible logic mappings from four inputs to four outputs. What's the equivalent in an analog world? Is it just a straight array of resistors and capacitors, or is it something more sophisticated? What's a reasonable range of component values? Like I say, if you can include zero and infinity for resistors and capacitors, then you can, you know, change these things into wires, or you can change them into open circuits. Which seems pretty important. So you want some kind of non-linearity in your component value mapping. Do you want to include op-amps and transistors and things like that, or do you want to keep them very low level and build up the same way that in the digital version we basically have simple logic blocks and build flip-flops and memories and such out of that? What's the right granularity, in other words, to pitch this internal general circuit? How big is your truth table? How much precision do you want on the component values and so on? And then, of course, how do you actually implement it? All good questions and some good project ideas or presentation ideas in there. Very simply coming up with a design for an analog cell that addresses some of these issues would be an interesting project and or presentation. Doing some simulation of a simple design using a full-blown analog simulator like SPICE or something simple to simulate a small matrix. There are things called field programmable transistor arrays, which are like FPGAs, but they're analog. And you can basically take transistors and put them together and build small analog circuits out of that. So maybe implementing on top of something like that, the same way you can implement a digital cell matrix on top of an FPGA. More presentation ideas, just sort of doing an overview of analog devices in general, looking at transistor arrays that are available today and sort of seeing what the state of the art is. Looking at applications for analog arrays would be interesting. This is a fairly new area. And one of the really interesting areas for this, and I'm going to talk about this probably next week, unless we have time today, is in the area of evolvable hardware, which I've mentioned a few times before. But that's an area that it got popular in the late 90s. A lot of work going on in Europe in it, but the US government started getting interested in the 90s, especially NASA and Department of Defense. The idea of, instead of explicitly designing circuitry, sort of randomly developing circuitry and evolving it to come up with a system that does some task you're interested in. And you can do this in the digital domain, you can do it in the analog domain, or you can do both. And we'll talk about some of the work that's been done in there. But like I say, I'll get to that probably on Monday. Okay, the more interesting version of this to me is the idea of having continuous cells. Okay, now they're not just analog. The inputs and outputs are continuous or analog values, just like in the analog matrix. But the difference is the truth table actually maps continuous numbers to continuous numbers, real numbers to real numbers. So if you had a cell with one variable, just one input and one output, okay, that basically implements one function, y equals some function of x, takes in a real number, and we'll just assume our numbers go between, say, 0 and 1, and produces an output between 0 and 1. And it can be pretty much any continuous function that you like. Okay, that would be a cell with one input and one output. It's sort of a zero-dimensional matrix. It's just one cell. And you need some sort of way to store this lookup table, okay, which takes in a real value input and produces a real valued output. And we sort of talked about one of those right before and after break. You can do it with basically a graph, okay, a function. For example, this is the transfer function. It takes one data input along the x output, produces one data output, and the mapping is given by mathematical sign. And if you can draw a picture of this, you can think of this as representing the transfer function or the mapping from input to output. Okay, now how do you implement that? I mentioned briefly a couple of weeks ago the idea of an acoustic memory. And this was used in the UNIVAC system back in the early 1950s. And the idea was they basically took these tubes, filled them with mercury, which is a very dense liquid, and then put an actuator on one side. They could apply an electrical signal, which would generate a pulse, and that pulse would create a wave in this fluid of mercury, and that wave would move from one end of the tube to the other. And because it's a dense liquid, it would take a certain amount of time to move, and then when it came to the other end, they could sense the wave, reshape it, and then transmit it back to the beginning, circulate it through again. Okay, this made a memory. And these were some of the early acoustic delay line tubes that were used, and I mean, literally just these long metal tubes filled with this fluid. And then I don't know if the marketing people got a hold of it or what, but they turned it into something that looked more like this, which I think is much cooler. And this was actually one of the acoustic memory delay lines that was used in the UNIVAC. And when you took a bunch of these and you put them together, you got a really cool looking piece of hardware like this, with these memories sitting here and then all the support logic. And this is just a memory. I mean, this is like a RAM or something. This is like, you know, 64 gig and a little chip now. But this was like hardcore engineering back then.
It's a lot of mercury.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Imagine how much it
weighs. I kind of hate the thought of like working back then. Because I think they sort of knew about mercury. I remember my dad playing with mercury. I mean, we broke a thermometer and he was like showing us all the weird stuff it does. He's like, hey, you put it on your finger, it disappears, you know? Yeah, science always has this. I mean, they used to use x-ray machines at shoe stores to tell if your shoes were fit properly. And they would just like, I mean, you'd wiggle your toes while your foot was being radiated and the fluoroscope would show you your bones. And they just didn't know, you know? So, interesting times. So C-mode operation on a continuous cell would be pretty straightforward. Basically, you have this tube, right? Okay, so we're still thinking mercury. You have this tube and you have a wave going through it, hits the end, it gets transmitted back to the beginning and goes through. When you would put a cell in C mode, okay, the destination cell, you just sort of open up the input. You stop feeding a signal in. You just sort of open up the line that drives that transducer. And then the cell that's doing the configuration, you basically take the output from the end of its tube and use that signal to drive the transducer on the destination cell's input. And now the waveform that's traveling through the source cell's tube is basically being copied into destination tube. And then when you leave C mode, you basically reconnect that feedback loop, you take the output, send it back in, and now you flash whatever that waveform was that you read from the source cell. And that's all that you need for C mode operation. You're basically just taking this waveform and just replicating it. And it's analogous in some way to having someone sing a song and you listen to it and then you go away and you sing it yourself to someone else and they hear it and memorize it and sing it to someone else. I mean, that's like a C-mode operation, basically. It's something that's very innate, but would let you basically copy cells the same way that you do on a digital version. Okay, now the D-mode is a little trickier. when you're trying to take inputs and map them to outputs, you need some way to basically analyze that sine wave that you've stored and say, well, I want the value of the function at 0.6, and I need to somehow figure out that its value is, you know, negative 0.8 or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Would you have them all have the same period?
Probably, yeah.
In that case, wouldn't you just work on the domain of a period of the wave and just do operations on that?
Say again?
Basically, you just always do everything based on the whole period of the wave. So let's say if you're adding two sigmas, you're going to just add the whole...
Yeah.
Every point in the...
I mean, it depends on what your retrieval method is. Uh-huh. How you're going to say, give me the value at some point where this point is itself the output of some other cell. But if you're storing these things as waves, then you probably need some kind of standard periodicity. And when you want to change frequency, you do that by scaling somewhere else. Although you could, I mean,
wait, how can you change frequency without changing the period?
Well, other than continuity concerns, I mean, you can store a function that looks like this in the tube, and you just sort of get this big jump from here back down to here. So I think you could probably store different period frequencies. There's this sort of endpoint continuity question.
Well, if you think about it as a string under tension rather than a tube, then all you have to do to change the frequency is to change the tension on the string.
Can you do that without changing length? Really?
Yeah, but you have a window.
Yeah.
I mean, you can only go so high before you break the string.
Right. Yeah, there's definite limits.
Otherwise, you've got to put a smaller string on it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because then you have less, because it's a function of mass and tension.
Right.
That the string vibrates at. But.
Yeah, and you could do this with a string instead of, I mean, I'm not really suggesting to use mercury tubes.
Now, the only thing is, if you're going to have something physical like that, whenever it reaches the hand, it's going to reflect back.
Yes and no. So I think on these delay lines, they had a transducer that basically absorbed the energy of the wave. So the wave would hit the end, and the energy would be transferred to...
Well, what's the efficiency of the conversion? You're not going to get 100%.
No, but if you absorb enough of the energy that the reflection doesn't make it back to the beginning, and then, like I say, you reshape the wave you're expecting, say, a sinusoid with certain patterns that indicate ones and zeros, and so you reshape it, you get a dirty signal back, but... If it's close to a one, you reshape it to a perfect one, and so on. Same thing you do with dynamic memory today. You read your voltage level, it's high enough to be a one, but it's a little degraded, so you pump it back up, store it again.
This is kind of off topic, but out of curiosity, would it be possible to take an analog circuit within, or an analog cell within one of these systems and use it to like generate a sine wave with a pretty high frequency, where at some point in the circuit you had something sampling the value of it at like the low, maybe like 1,000 foot, I don't know, 1,000 foot, or whatever your, you know, your scale is. So you could have it be a pretty quick pseudo-random number generator. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you should be able to do that. And I think you can do that on a digital matrix too. The taking an inverter and feeding its output back to its input should give you a high frequency oscillator. And then you sample it based on a system clock. Same idea.
But wouldn't it?
But you can do a lot of interesting random number generation with analog circuitry. If you take a transistor and you leave its input open and let it just sort of pick up environmental noise, you can make a generator out of that. I think NEC actually sold one many years ago, random number generator on a chip. Now, it's not truly random, but it's based on information you presumably can't predict, especially today with cell phones and stuff going on. So you could definitely do some interesting random or pseudo-random generation. So to read the values out of this, you need to, well, I already had one, I didn't have to draw it. You need to be able to pick out some point along the domain and pick out the function value in order to read the stored transfer function. If the wave is moving through mercury, so this just gets into some kind of stuff to think about. you got this tube of mercury and you've got some wave traveling through here. And let's suppose it takes 1 second for a signal at the beginning to reach the end. Okay. So one option is to place a sensor right here at the end. And you have some notion of time. You know where the beginning of this wave is. And so if you want to read a value that's sitting at 0.6, you wait exactly 0.4 seconds until that value reaches the end. And then you look at the sensor and you see what value the wave has. And that's your output value for 0.6. Okay, so you can read the exact value assuming you wait for the exact amount of time. But it's going to take you a little bit of delay until you can get the value out. So your delay can be up to 1 second. But the error is going to be zero. You should be able to read the exact value. Now, if you don't have a second to wait to read this memory, suppose your maximum tolerable delay is a half a second. So you can do the same thing. You can have the sensor here, and you can wait a half a second, up to a half second until your value gets here. Now, if you're trying to read the value at 0.6, you'll get it in 4/10 of a second. If you're trying to read a value at 0.3, well, after half a second, it'll be up here, but you'll actually be reading the value that's at 0.8. Sorry, at 0.5 instead of 0.3. So you're going to have some error, but you can cap off what your maximum delay is. Okay, so you're trading off efficiency for accuracy. Another option is to put a bunch of sensors along here. Say every 1/10 of the tube. And then wait up to 1/10 of a second for whatever value you're after to hit the next sensor in the tube and then read off the exact value. And so there your delay is up to 1/10 of a second, but you get, again, a precise reading of your function value out. So you've got a small delay and you've got perfect precision. Or if you don't want to wait at all, you can simply read the sensor that's closest to the value you're interested in. You have absolutely no delay, but you have some potential small amount of error corresponding to the distance between your sensors. And the more sensors you have, the smaller this delay is, the smaller this error is. But if you force the delay to zero, you're going to have an error. And if you put a cap on your delay, then you're going to have some sort of precision error. And it's a little sort of reminiscent of maybe something Heisenbergish, trying to get precise information about energy and position of an electron can't be done. There's an inherent trade-off between them. And there seems to be some sort of trade-off here between time and precision in trying to read these values out. So just something to think about. Okay, so that's all for the zero-dimensional case. The slightly more interesting case is a one-dimensional matrix. So you have two inputs and two outputs on each side. Sorry, two sides. Input and output on each of two sides of a cell. And you basically have just a big, long, skinny matrix. So you can store lookup tables with two functions. Each function takes in two inputs and generates one output. And this basically needs a two-input lookup table. And so again, we normalize everything between 0 and 1. So your eastern input is some value along here, and your western input is some value along the y-axis. And we have some point at which we would want to read the value of the lookup table, the function value. And I suggested this before, you could think of this as sort of a three-dimensional shape, something like a drum head, where at each point you have some deformation of this surface, and the higher it is, the higher the function value. And if you could somehow store something in this three-dimensional shape, you could actually store a function of two variables. Then you'd have two of these for your lookup table, one for the eastern output, one for the western. And again, you can do this with maybe a traveling wave, but going through a two-dimensional surface instead of through a linear tube. And so for C-mode, again, it's the same thing. You have some vibration on the surface. You need to just clone that onto another surface. And that may be doable. Some physics problems there I'm not versed in. The readout is again the more interesting question. So how do you actually put in a particular pair of values, east and west, and read out the value at some location here? Because you have this two-dimensional space here. actually, this is more a C mode question than a D mode. If you wanted to read out the values from this, so C mode, not D mode, with a one-dimensional lookup table, right, we think of this as time is zero and this is 1 second, we can basically just sweep the lookup table for 1 second, read the value at each point, and send that out to the output or send it into the D input and configure the new lookup table. But how do you do that with a two-dimensional region? How do you go through all these values in a fixed amount of time? And one way is to sort of do a scan, come up with some back and forth, go back and forth, say, 8 times or 7 times, sweeping through this, and do it fast enough so that at time zero, you're reading this value, and at time one, you're reading this value. And you can see the trade-off. If you have fewer scan lines, then you don't have to move as quickly, but if you wanted the value, say, at this point, well, you have to read the value at this point instead. There's a precision loss there. If you have more scan lines, you can get more accurately the value at any point, but it's going to take you longer to sweep. And so there's limits to the accuracy of this readout method. And so again, it's a trade-off between accuracy versus time. Okay, another idea. Are you familiar with fractals? Heard of them? Fractals are, there's a lot of ways to look at them. One way to look at fractals is they're things that no matter what scale you look at, you can't really tell what the scale is. They look the same, whether you're very much zoomed in or very much zoomed out. A classic example of a fractal is a coastline. If you look at the coastline of the United States, it looks something like that, the West Coast. It's a terrible drawing. And you can go to a map that's drawn to scale, and you can put a piece of thread along there and measure how long the coast is. Okay, but if you look at a much more detailed drawing of it, you find the coast actually looks more like this. It has all these little ins and outs. And if you measure the length of that coastline, it's going to come out a lot longer than this one, because it has all these little jogs to it. And if you go to an even finer scale, you're going to get an even longer coast. And the further you take this measurement, the longer the coast comes out to be. And that's an example of fractal behavior. It's something that at some scale seems to be finite in length, but another scale is actually infinite. So Hilbert came up with this idea of a space-filling curve. And you can't really draw the final version of the curve, but you can approach it. And the first version of the curve is just a simple three lines. So this is a region, again, 0 to 1 in each dimension. And you can break it into four regions, and you basically traverse one point in each region. And that's your first order Hilbert curve. Your second order, you take each of these regions and break them up into four, and you traverse one point in each of those using the first order curve. So you move like this, and then you draw a Hilbert curve there, and so on and so forth. Your third order Hilbert curve, you take each of these regions and traverse them, break them into four regions and traverse them with a first order Hilbert curve, and you get something like this. And if you keep expanding this out, what you find is a curve that covers more and more of the points inside this region, but you can always map to a unit interval. And this unit interval could represent time, so t equals 0 seconds, t equals 1 second, and as you move along this curve, you cover more and more points in this two-dimensional region. And you can do it in a finite amount of time, 1 second in particular. And so you might be able to sweep through this two-dimensional function table by using something like a space-filling curve. And the idea is, in the limit, you basically have a single line which starts down here and takes some weird path throughout all of this. But it hits every single point in this two-dimensional region. Every xy value is somewhere on this line, and so it represents some point between 0 and 1. And so in 1 second, you can scan every point in this region. Okay, so you can get an exact readout of your function at any point in at most 1 second. It's a semi-theoretical idea. I have no idea how to actually implement that, but. Okay, and it's called space filling curve. Do you know why these things are called fractals? Fractions.
Yeah, isn't it like the triangle one, like fractures and the fractions?
Yeah, it does.
I mean, that was one of the earlier ones, I'm guessing.
Exact same idea, though. Yeah. In general, when you have a line, it has some length, and its width is zero. Okay, so it has a length which is non-zero, but its area equals zero. If you take the length times the width, it's zero. Okay, that's why a line is one-dimensional, because it has no two-dimensional area. It only has one-dimensional area, if you like, which is the length. When you take a square or a rectangle, it has some length, it has some width, and it has some fixed area, okay, 1, 2, 5, whatever, and that makes it two-dimensional, and it has no volume. If you multiplied it by its height, or its thickness, it would be zero. So it's not three-dimensional, it's two-dimensional. But this space-filling curve, its length is infinite, and its width is zero, yet it fills in this two-dimensional area. Okay, it has some area which is greater than zero. So it's bigger than one-dimensional, because it has an area, but it's not quite two-dimensional, because if it was two-dimensional and its length was infinite, then its area would be infinite. So its dimensionality is somewhere between 1 and 2, and for some of these, you could work out mathematically what their dimensionality is, and they're like 1.71 dimensional. Okay, so that's where the fractal part comes from sometimes, is fractional dimension. Okay, they're kind of in between 1D and 2D objects, which is why they can do weird things like fill in a 2D area even though they have no width. Okay, now what would you do with a continuous cell matrix? And we can write the truth tables just as functions that we draw inside a block. So if you have a function, and we'll just think of input on the bottom and output on the left, if your function line is flat down here, what function is this representing?
Zero.
Yeah. This is just y equals zero. And if you have a function up here, that's y equals one. Okay, so those are just your false and true blocks. What would this be?
X. Y equals x.
Y equals x, that's a wire. Okay, so you can make zeros and ones and wires. We're in pretty good shape so far. And what would this be?
Negative x.
Basically, yeah, it's an inverter. And if you go minus 1 to 1, it's just negative x. If you go 0 to 1, it's 1 minus x, I think. But it basically gives you the opposite value out from what you're getting in. So you can make inverters. You can make logic gates out of this pretty simply. So you can do all your digital processing with this also. You make something like this. Any guess?
Your writing clock.
Could be. It's also something else. This is actually an amplifier, because you get a little bit of input over here and you get a big output. And you get a little more input and you get a bigger output. it amplifies an incoming voltage, say. It's a linear amplifier, and then of course at some point your input is so great that your output is overdriven and you're clipping your output, so you get distortion. But up to this point, it's basically just a linear amplifier. Okay, all these things are one cell. The amplification in one cell, that's pretty cool. If you take a cell and you store some kind of waveform, put one into its C input, you take its D output, feed it back in, and then send this out here. Right, you've got a function generator. This will output this waveform that you stored over here. So you can make a triangle wave generator or a sinusoid or anything like that, to cell function generator. This one's a little bit of a stretch. But if you store a sine wave in here, now you have a sine wave coming into this middle cell. And you make this a multiplier, because you can multiply two functions. Just store the right lookup table to say A times B. And now you have some input signal here. It gets multiplied by a sine wave, and you get some output over here. This is an amplitude modulator. Okay, this is how you make an AM radio transmitter. It basically takes a carrier wave, which is a sine, and then it changes the amplitude based on some input. So, something like that. It's a radio transmitter in three cells. Okay, so these are pretty powerful cells. You could do, much more powerful than just a straight analog matrix. The trick, of course, is that you're somehow able to store these lookup tables and retrieve them. But if you can do that, you have a general transfer function storage and retrieval capability, you can do some really powerful circuitry with just a few cells. Okay. This, I think, is the future. I think this is sort of somewhere it would be really good for engineering to go. Because you're not shaping waves, you're not around electrons, you're not trying to differentiate currents and voltages and things like that. You're actually storing functions. Okay, we talked about lookup tables. Lookup tables are everywhere. Well, this is the essence of just storing and retrieving lookup tables. And it's a different kind of engineering, but I think it would be a really powerful way to do a lot of circuitry. All right, I cheated here. I had a lookup table with three inputs. Doing three inputs is a harder problem. You basically have a three-dimensional volume, and you need to store values in there somehow. And we touched on this briefly the other day. Storing the temperature, changing the temperature in some volume of gas, and using that to store values, trying to do pressure or something else. A really good idea might be phase. And holograms basically store phase information from a 3D region. And perhaps you can code your analog values as a phase throughout a region of space and then retrieve it the same way you look at holograms. And traversing it, again, you could try to do something like a space filling curve. You can have a 3D version, which is like a volume filling curve, which might look something like that, which also looks a little like a Borg cube. So, all right, we're out of time. I'll end it there. Friday, optional lab, work on homework 3 or anything else. And Monday, we'll probably talk a little about gullible hardware and go from there. So, any other questions, feel free to shoot an email.